We now welcome to Larry King Live another visit. She's been on frequently. Hillary Rodham Clinton, the First Lady of the United States, Senator-elect in the state of New York, author of the new book, An Invitation to the White House, At Home with History. We'll talk about that a little later. How do I address you now? I know you're so long. Is it Madam First Lady, Hillary Rodham, Senator?
It's a little confusing, isn't it?
Yes. What do you like best?
Well, all of those are, you know, really wonderful things.
Do you call a Senator-elect a Senator?
I don't know. That's a good question. You know, I've been telling people that I'm not a senator until I'm sworn in on January 3rd. So, how about Hillary?
But you like the term senator?
I do like the term.
Yeah. It fits?
I feel very good about it. You know, it was a great campaign. I had the help of thousands and thousands of people across New York and lots of friends around the country. And I'm very excited. I went to Senate school last week.
What was that like?
It was great.
Senate school?
Oh, yes. I mean, it was wonderful. I mean, we had an opportunity to hear Senator Byrd talk about the history of the Senate, and we did it in the old Senate chambers where so much of that history took place. I spent time meeting my new colleagues, both Democrats and Republicans. It was a really good way to start getting oriented toward the Senate.
Did you get your office yet?
No, that won't happen for several months. We're all, as the new freshman class, we're all in the basement of the Dirksen building. In the basement, because we have to wait our turn to see what space is available. The seniority system works so that people can move, and people who retired or lost will obviously vacate their space, and then
next one moves up,
and then, you know, I'm down toward the bottom of the order.
Well, doesn't the Secret Service say we'd rather have her in this?
No, it's all by seniority. It's every bit of it.
They don't have clout.
No clout. But that's fine. We'll have a good time no matter what.
Lots of things to talk about, but first things first. What do you make of all this? And I don't have to even say what all this is.
Well, you know, as we're speaking, the Supreme Court arguments are going on, and we don't know what the outcome is going to be.
So let's say what if. What if the outcome is they can't vote anymore, they can't count anymore? Well, what if it's Bush's will be president? You expect Gore will give it up then?
Well, you know, I'm not going to engage in the what-if game. I think that, you know, from everything I've seen and heard, more people probably did intend to vote for Vice President Gore. And I would hope that there will still be an opportunity to have the votes counted, because I think that's the best for whoever is inaugurated as president. But it's now in the courts, and we'll leave it to the Supreme Court, which we'll find out maybe later today or tomorrow.
If the court says it's, let's say they say it's Bush, can you, what it's going to be like, do you think, working with a president of the other party with a 50-50 Senate?
Well, I think everyone's going to have to make a real effort to work together. There's too much at stake for the country. I certainly intend to work wherever I can in a bipartisan way, both with fellow senators and members of Congress across the aisle, as well as with anyone else, including a possible administration. I think that on so many of the matters that the country cares about, we were divided nearly 50-50 in the presidential race. We are certainly divided very closely in the Congress. Divided in the court. So there has to be an effort to reach across party lines and look for ways that people can cooperate.
Because you can make it a stagnation, right? Either party can do that.
Well, that certainly is the prerogative, I suppose, but I hope that's not the priority of either party or any leader of either party, because when you come to questions about the economy or education or health care, these are all matters that I think, despite the closeness of the election, the American people have made clear they want some action taken.
Do you think we ought to change our voting system? Do you think that the federal government ought to help local communities by supplying equipment? I mean, this is the year 2000. You would think that we could vote like an ATM machine.
Well, Larry, I think we have to take a hard look at how we vote, and particularly in federal elections. There ought to be a way for the federal government to perhaps provide some assistance to work toward a standardized ballot that states would be asked to consider accepting. I think that these are all matters that will be taken up in the 107th Congress, but it's critical that people have confidence in our electoral process. You know, I went all over the state of New York, as I have on behalf of my husband and other candidates over the last 30 years, urging people to vote, trying to reverse the trend of the last 30 or 40 years of lower and lower voter turnout. I just don't think we can afford for people to believe that their vote wouldn't even be counted literally, so that when we tell and encourage Americans to get out and vote, we really mean it, and that we'll have a system that can fairly and accurately count their intention to vote for the candidate they chose.
Because it seems ridiculous if the CHAD doesn't get punched through and the machine can't read it. And there's so many things we could do electronically
Absolutely.
Today. That should be covered. Didn't we think that everybody voted the same? In New York City, when I grew up, we pull levers.
Right.
They still do that?
That's what I did in Westchester.
Right. That's the safest, because you can't vote for two people for the same office. Mm-hmm. You can turn the lever back up, and when you open the gate, it's open. Mm-hmm. Why can't that be standardized?
Well,
it seems simple.
I like voting machines because, just as you described them, they make voting very clear, and you can't really make a mistake if you try to vote for two people in the same office. The machine won't let you do it. But in New York, for example, which does use those machines, people aren't even making some of the machines that are still used. They're hard to get spare parts for. So we have to take a hard look, perhaps with a commission or some kind of joint congressional committee, to look and see what is the best technology, the safest, most accurate technology. Because questions can be raised about any form of voting. You know, some people talk about online voting, but imagine if there were an electrical surge or a blackout and whole states or regions of the country lost their votes. How would we handle that? So every way we think about voting, we'll have some questions. But clearly, we have to learn from this experience that in our democracy, the oldest surviving democracy in the history of the world, the most fundamental task for our government is to provide an election that people have confidence in. And so when they go to vote, they know their vote will be counted.
In a minute, we'll ask about whether you think this president, no matter who it is, it's a tainted presidency. We'll be right back with Hillary Rodham Clinton, Senator-elect, State of New York, First Lady, United States, mother, husband, wife. We'll be right back. You're an only. You're the only First Lady ever to win elective office.
So far.
The Secret Service won't be allowed on the Senate floor, will they?
No.
They have to stay up in the gallery.
Well, they're working it out with the Capitol Police and the Sergeant at Arms, who've been very cooperative. They understand the issues that they have to take into account.
Is this a tainted presidency?
I hope not. I mean, I really hope that however this is finally resolved, that the country will really decide that we need to act in a bipartisan way, and we'll do so.
If you could change the Constitution, would you make it a popular vote?
Well, I would, because I think that that really is the intent of one person, one vote. But I have no illusions that that is not likely to occur, because it would take a constitutional amendment. That's why I favor doing everything we can to make our electoral systems as fair and accurate as possible.
Everyone has said, except maybe you, that you are going to run for president someday. So let's say Gore loses. That means the Democratic Party has no incumbent. Are you interested in that office in 2004?
No, I'm not.
Not at all?
No. I am intent upon being the best senator that I can be. That is what I want to do. I really feel like the people of New York gave me a great honor to give me the opportunity to serve. And that's what I am interested in doing. All of the work that I've done for 30 years now, it's almost hard to imagine going back into my young adulthood, concerns, children and families and education and economic opportunity and health care. I think we will have an opportunity, no matter how our presidential campaign is finally resolved, for people of good faith to reach across party lines and try to hammer out some of the solutions that I really think the American people want us to work toward.
Did you tell the people of New York that you are going to stay the six
years? Yes, I surely did.
And you wouldn't change
No,
that?
I wouldn't. Mm-mm.
So that's as definitive as you can get,
As definitive as I can get.
Are you complimented by the thought?
Well, people say a lot of things about me. Some of it
How
is
How did you react to the bitterness, the anger that campaign presented for a while? And then you won rather clearly, but...
I
Do you like it?
I loved campaigning, and
I did,
and I absolutely fell in love with every part of New York. I cannot tell you how much I enjoyed the days that I spent on the campaign trail, traveling all over, staying in people's homes.
Even Bensonhurst.
I loved everywhere.
Brooklyn,
everywhere. But now you said you were going with me, and you didn't come.
My friends Sid and Asher, they were going to go with me.
Yes, so we'll have to reschedule
that. You did well there, though.
I did. I was very gratified by the outcome of the election.
Committee chairman, now there's a movement here now that the Republicans say since it's 50-50, but
right.
They have the vice president if Bush is the president. Democrats want committee chairman shared. What do you think?
Well, I think there are a number of issues that Tom Daschle, as the leader of the Democrats, will be negotiating with Senator Lott, and that's one of them. But there are other issues, seats on committees, staff and other budgetary considerations, the rules of how the Senate operates. You know, I was very impressed by what Senator Byrd told us in his lecture about the way the Senate had always functioned ever since the early 19th century, so that individual senators were able to present amendments, that matters could be brought to the floor. And I think we need to, you know, have an agreement to go back to having the Senate function the way the Senate historically has functioned. So there's a lot at stake in these negotiations.
You'd favor co-chairmanship, though?
No, not necessarily. No, because I think that it'll either be 51-49 or 50-50 with a vice presidential tie-breaking vote. And so I think that that's something to be negotiated.
Any committee you want to serve on?
Well, I'm open to a number of committees, and
what
we're not going to.
What would be your favorite?
I'm not going to get into that right now because I'm standing in line like everybody else. But we don't even know how the committees will be chosen because, as you just pointed out, we don't know how many members will be on the various committees. And I'm just going to wait my turn. Democrats will make those decisions at the leadership level, and I'll work as hard as I can on whatever committee I'm appointed to.
Did you take offense to Trent Lott's statement that you don't expect anything? You're just another wheel in the cog in the wheel.
Well, you know, I'm just one of 100, and that's a factual statement. People say things sometimes in the heat of partisanship, and we've had a very cordial encounter in the Senate. We went from Senator Daschle's office to Senator Lott's office, and he gave us a wonderful history lesson about that office and the role that it's played in the history of the Congress.
How do he treat you?
Very cordially, very collegially, which is what I expected. I have gotten to know him and his wife over the last 8 years, and I expect there will be differences, obviously. He has a role to play and a party to represent, but I imagine wherever we can, we'll try to work together, and certainly I see no reason for us not to be in a very collegial, cordial relationship.
So you're optimistic that this government can work, that this can be four fruitful years? No matter who's sitting at in this house.
Well, I believe that America is at heart an optimistic country. You know, we are people of an optimistic spirit, and we have work to do. And work doesn't get done if people are drawn into battles over issues that are not going to make a difference in the lives of ordinary Americans. You know, my hope is that in my work and the work of those in the Senate, you know, we will be able to keep the economy strong and growing. We will be able to improve education and provide health care and protect the environment, all of the things that I campaigned on. You can't do that if you're more interested in scoring political points.
How about the leftover vituperativeness?
Well, that's for others to judge. You know,
I admit it's bitter.
Well, there has been a lot of bitter feelings and rhetoric, but I think that if you are willing to overlook that, not let it get in the way of trying to forge some solution to a problem, to try to help people, it certainly is possible, and that's what I'm going to try to do.
We'll talk about this house, Christmas here, and with the lady of the house. She's still the lady of the house. Hillary Rodham Clinton, Senator-elect New York. Don't go away. Okay, you're right, it takes a village. You're right, dear socks, dear buddy, kids' letters to first pets. And now we have an invitation to the White House at home with history.
Right.
And you don't make money from this, right?
Goes to the White House
Historical Association. Simon used to publish. This is what, the 200th anniversary?
This is the 200th anniversary of this wonderful house. You know, the first occupants were the Adams. And although President Washington chose the site and oversaw the construction, he never lived here.
He surveyed it,
absolutely. And Thomas Jefferson submitted an anonymous design plan, which wasn't chosen. But over these 200 years, this house has really served as a symbol of our democracy, as an office for the president, and a museum for American history and culture, as well as a home.
The book is a compendium of those years?
The book is really an inside look at what it's like to live here, both the informal moments that we spend together as a family, but the more formal public moments as well, the historic peace treaty signings, the state visit of Nelson Mandela, the kinds of things that I wanted to give people a behind-the-scenes look at. And I wanted to share this experience, which has been not only unique, but so wonderful for me personally and for our family.
Last Christmas here, thoughts on that?
Well, it's really kind
of... You love Christmas.
I do. I love Christmas.
We've spent a lot of Christmases here.
Yes, we have. This is our eighth Christmas. Yeah. Well, it's a bittersweet moment. I mean, because it will be our last Christmas, but we are trying to enjoy every minute of it. I'm not sure that any of us will get much sleep between now and the end of the season, because we're trying to be as open and entertaining as we can of so many people who are going to come that we can say thank you to and goodbye to. So it's been a reflection of the previous years. That's really the theme for this Christmas season.
How'd you get the idea to do this book?
You know, people ask me all the time, you know, what's it like living there? And how many rooms are there? And what's a state dinner like? And how do you decide what to serve? What's it like meeting the famous people that you've met? And this couldn't possibly cover everything that has happened, but it does really put the focus on the house, which no matter who the first family is, no matter what president sits here, this house is bigger than any of us, and it goes on and on, and the permanent staff is such a treasure that I wanted everybody to know what I know about the people who serve. No matter who the president is, they are here to make the house run, to keep it beautiful, and to help any first family.
Do you have a favorite room?
You know, I have so many rooms. You know, this one that we're in right now is the map room, and this is where President Franklin Roosevelt plotted our strategy for the Allied victory in World
War II.
Including
the last map he saw, German embankment right behind me.
Exactly, and when I got here, I asked, well, what is this room? And I was told its historic significance, but there were no maps left. So I started a hunt that ended with finding a young lieutenant, still alive, who was serving President Roosevelt when he died at Warm Springs, Georgia. And this was the map that President Roosevelt was working on when he died, and this young lieutenant rolled it up and took it away and has had it for all of these years. And when he heard that, now that he's an obviously much older man, that we were looking for something that would really signify the importance of this room, he donated it to the White House. And I've walked in here for meetings, and I've seen people staring at it. One time I came in and there were tears running down a man's face because he'd been in the Allied forces that fought their way from Italy north. Another time I came in and there was a very distinguished economist who was just standing before it in speechless wonder, because he at that time was a young man, a boy, living in Germany. And his father had been conscripted into the Nazi army and had been lost, and his mother and his sister were starving in Berlin, and they were liberated by the Allied forces. So that's what I love about this house, is that it is a living home, but it is also a repository of that history.
Is it warm to you?
I love it. It's warm, it's welcoming, and I've tried to make it that way.
It's not unwelcoming.
Oh, no. I hope not, anyway.
No, because it can be.
Can be overpowering because of the awe that it inspires and the size that it is. But that's why I wanted to take people behind the scenes in the book. I wanted everyone to see that here's a place that was our home, as well as where we entertained for very special public events.
Do you always feel like a tenant?
You know, that's a hard question to answer. I always feel in awe. I've never walked into this house, no matter what time of day, no matter how tired I was, where I was coming from, that I wasn't grateful and that I wasn't awestruck by it. You know that you're just passing through, that it is a place that others lived before and will live after you. So in that sense, you always know that you're just temporary. But we worked very hard to make it our home.
Well, the book's a classic work of art.
Thank you.
And giving it to the White House Association, as a historical association, is a great idea. One final thing. It's inaugural day. Somebody's being sworn in.
Right.
Will that be a joyous occasion, no matter who? Or will it be, what's going on?
Oh, you know, it's going to be a poignant moment for me, because the 8 years will be ending. My husband's presidency will be ending. I will be assuming a different role. My husband will be going on, I know, to do other things. So no matter what the outcome of the election, it's going to be poignant. But it will also be very reinforcing. You know, I am such a strong believer in the fundamental strength of American values and institutions You know, I'm just a dyed-in-the-wool sort of sentimental patriot about what our country means. And the orderly, peaceful transfer of power is something that we have demonstrated for, you know, more than two centuries.
So if it's George Bush raising his right hand, there's no biting of the bottom lip?
Not for me. For me, I'm hoping that when this is finally resolved, and of course I believe strongly that the best evidence of the way it should be resolved are the votes of the people who actually voted in the election. But it is in the courts, and when it is resolved, certainly, you know, I'm prepared to serve with and to, you know, to watch whoever the next president is swear loyalty to our Constitution.
Madam Senator-elect First Lady, thank you very much.
Thank you, Larry.